I'm so tired. Today is a heavy film day. I have two things to film today because I couldn't film during the week. I'm trying to be more consistent, like get ahead of all of the things. And so, okay, so this is gonna be broken up into two videos. It's gonna be my things I do to take care of myself as a law student and my common questions I get about getting into a T14 with a low LSAT score. So we'll talk about them in separate videos, but like that's what I'm filming here. So I'm gonna have the same shirt on for both days, so don't look at me like I'm gonna look the same for both days, right? But it's gonna be broken up into two videos. And okay, sun is sunning. Sun is sunning. The sun has not come out in days, y'all. It has not come out in a very, very long time. Wow, the sun is sunning. Okay, well, I'm sorry. It's not even that bright. It's like still behind the cloud. Ow, I should not have looked directly at it. Jeez. So once the tea is done, I'm gonna walk back over here and we're going to get started on our common questions that I get about getting into a T14 with a low LSAT score. And this is with the assumption that you have a good GPA, meaning like 3.5 and above. Like, I think having a low LSAT score and like a low GPA, I don't know about that. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know how that would look. I'm sure you could, the tips still apply, probably. Usually I'm a very like, oh, sky's the limit, anything is possible. But I think that energy can sometimes be misconstrued as like, I could do the bare minimum and like not try and still get what I want. Like that kind of energy is not necessarily what I subscribe to. So I think I've just had a change of heart when it comes to the way that I talk about getting into law school, because I recognize that like I'm in a way promoting delusion, but I love delusion, right? We all love delusion, but in a way I feel like it's can be unhealthy if you don't put in like some kind of effort into the delusion that you are believing or wanting, whatever. So yeah, wow, no earrings, no rings. I really am just like, you're getting like bare dial. You're getting the most basic of me, right? Like showing up with no earrings and no extra rings. Obviously I always have these, but no extra rings, I'm not even trying today, am I? I'm not even making attempts, right? But these are gonna be good videos though, so like if you need this advice, if you are looking for like ways to take care of yourself, or if you just want to think about how it might look for you to take care of yourself when you're in law school, this might be a helpful, you know, helpful little thing to watch. I think I'm gonna start with the common questions I get about getting into a T14 with a low LSAT score, and then I'll do the other video about the other thing. So, okay, all right, let's get into it. The tea is smelling good. I am drinking a vanilla caramel chai, not just vanilla chai, caramel. Why am I smelling? I'm tired. I'm clearly exhausted. It smells wonderful. Can you see the steam in them? Oh, I don't know if you can. I can see it. Interesting. I don't know. Okay! Let's get started. This is a long intro. I'm sorry. But here are some common questions. Okay, so the point of this video, I told you guys in my last video that one thing I really love that you guys did a lot last year was that if you were a law student and you were in the law school admissions process, you would reach out to me, you would DM me, I really appreciate that. You would ask questions about personal statements, questions about like advice, tips, whatever, tricks, whatever. And I really appreciated that, but I noticed that I was getting the same question over and over again, which is fine. If you have that exact same question and you want a very tailored, personalized answer, please still DM me. My Instagram is at @theblackenneagram or at @yoursdialA. Which is the same like handle for my YouTube. So jumping right into it, because I know I love to talk, some disclaimers that I wanted to write down. Again, The iPad is my notes, so if I look down, it's because I'm looking at my iPad. Some disclaimers is, the goal isn't to get a low LSAT score. That's something I'm realizing that I need to say. Because getting a low LSAT score is not great. I mean, I get it. I got a low LSAT score. Like, I got a mid. My first took the exam, I got a very, very low LSAT score. Even as I continue to try, I don't think that a 152 is the low LSAT score. I think it's just a mid. It's a mid LSAT score. It wasn't like a, oh, wow. You know what I mean? That's just my personal opinion. Other people can see that and be like, oh my God, a 152? Wow. Like, that's, everything is subjective, at least to law students. To admissions people, it's a little bit less subjective, and it's like, what are the statistics? But my first disclaimer is, if you have more time, take more time and get a good score. A lot of the advice I'm gonna share is if it's like too late, right? But I wanna say, if you do have more time, if there's no rush for you to go to law school this fall, there really shouldn't be any rush, right? But I get it, I rushed, right? Like, I was like, I'm not gonna wait another semester or another year for me to go to law school. I can't do it. No, absolutely not. The LSAT would not have another year of my life, right? That was how I felt, that's why I did not. That's why I, even though I did have more time, right? Like, I was living at home, pandemic was going on. No one would have looked at me crazy if I decided to take another year off. But it was just like a personal thing. I know that's what it is for a lot of people. It's just a personal, like, I don't want to be taking this test for 2-3 years of my life, right? I get that. That's what I did. However, if you really, for two reasons, right? Your goal just shouldn't be to get a low LSAT score. Your goal should be to do the best that you can. It shouldn't be to get a low score and try to finesse your way. I think that's something that I don't know. Just, if this is more of a video for you just can't take another year of taking the test. Like, you cannot take another year of studying, which I understand. So that's my first disclaimer, is if you can take more time, take it. The LSAT score really does, unfortunately, it does affect scholarship, which is something that I struggled with. So I didn't get a lot of money for scholarship. I got some, right? Like, I got something, right? But it wasn't, my score didn't get me. It just didn't, right? That's just me. My story is different. Everyone has a unique story. I'm ashy, but you know what? I'm okay with that in this video. I'm okay with that. You wanna know why? I don't even know why, but I'm okay with that. This video is about the LSAT and getting into school. So it doesn't even matter how I look. Okay. Getting a better score just increases your chances of admission, increases your chances of scholarship. That's the only reason why. It's just, I just feel like I recommend taking more time. But again, like I said, if you can't, don't beat yourself up. I didn't beat myself up. I said, this is the best I can do. This is the best I can do, because that test was really like, it was changing me as a person. I didn't enjoy that, so I stopped. However, not everyone tests well, and not everyone has more time or wants to take more time. So here are some tips that I have. And I think that first piece about not everyone tests well is going to be important when we talk about addendums. Not everyone tests well. I'm not someone who I would say doesn't test well. I just need more, for an exam like the LSAT, I would have needed more time. It's not that I don't test well. I don't know. It was for some, I guess even if you do test well, the test is hard. Even if you don't test well, the test is even harder, right? Like, it doesn't really matter if you test well, but I can recognize how if someone doesn't really test well, this exam can pose more like barriers than it is. I don't know. I just feel like if you don't test well, I completely understand why you're just like, I have a low score and I don't think there's anything I can do about it. So therefore, I just want to see how I can get into a school with a low score, right? And if you do test well and you still aren't getting it, look, that's me. I was a normal test taker. I'm not gonna say I'm like wonderful, but like, I'm a normal test taker. I don't really need a lot of accommodations. And yet that test almost like took me out. So I completely get it. It's not a shaming, like, you should take more time, do more. I'm just saying, if you have more time, if you have the privilege of time and resources, take advantage of them. I did, and I didn't take advantage of them, and I low-key wish I had taken another year off to get a higher score, because I wouldn't be like swimming, drowning in debt right now, and I'm okay with that. I'm not afraid of debt. Some people are afraid of debt. I'm not afraid of debt. I pay my bills on time, you know what I mean? Like, I don't really worry about like debt, because I just wasn't raised to think about debt in a negative way. But if you are someone who cares about debt and money is a really big factor for you, it may be better to just take another year or so to study for the exam and get a better score. If you don't mind debt and you are okay with possibly not getting a lot of scholarship money, I'm not saying you will not get any. Like, the likelihood of you're not getting any, I think is low because, I mean, depending on the school. Let me not say that, because that's a really blanket statement. Depending on the school, yeah. Most schools give you something, right? So, yeah. I think that's all my disclaimers. Okay, some general advice I have, and then we'll go into, like, specific advice. So some tips or, you know, advice I have for someone who doesn't have the best LSAT score, I would say talk to honest current students at the law school, right? Because that's going to help you write your personal statement, and it's going to help you curate. I'm going to talk more about this later when I talk about personal statements, but it's going to help you curate let me start all over. Talk to honest current students, because these current students are students who got into the school, right? Ask them about what their experience was, what kind of experience do they have, right? Like, what did they write about on their personal statements? Get all that information from them. And if you start to notice a theme, like, maybe if you also have that theme in your life as well. So the theme for Berkeley is uniqueness, right? Like, having a different story than the normal, like, I was valedictorian and I did this and I was that and this, you know, like, that's, they're not a school that does the cookie cutter, like, perfect student thing. Like, they're a school that has, we have models, right? We have people who were models in their past life, people who were missing, like, you know, who were pageant girls in their past life, or who were news anchors in their past life, or who, you know, like people just, like, come from unique and different backgrounds that aren't always directly, like, related to the law. That's a theme that I saw with Berkeley students, is that they're very impressive, but they're not all impressive just academically. They're not all just impressive because of their, like, legal experience. They're impressive because they're well-rounded people who have a life. You know what I mean? Like, they are people, right? And that's one thing. If you're looking to get into Berkeley, that's a school. That's a theme that is important to them, is someone who has a very well-rounded experience in life and not just, like, academically savvy. So talk to honest current law students. The reason why I say honest, because I'm noticing, especially with people of color at like T14s, I think we like to lie to black or brown, whatever, people of color, who, like, prospective law students, because we just want more people of color in our school. But you're doing them a huge disservice, because when they come to the school and you tell them, oh yeah, it's gonna be like this, it's gonna be like that, it's like this and then that, and they come and it's not like that in this, they're gonna be disappointed, they're gonna be upset, they're like, who lied to me, right? That was my experience. As I came, I was gonna choose Berkeley no matter what. Even they said that Berkeley's crap and don't come to Berkeley, and Berkeley's, I would still come to Berkeley, but the problem that I had was, like, expectations versus reality. I think they would, I just wish that they would have given me reality, so that when I got here, I wasn't expecting what they told me. I just wish they had been honest with me, right? And I get why we do it. I get why people of color, like law students, like, not gonna lie, it's called lying, why we lie to prospective students. Or maybe we, like, I don't know if it's lying. I don't know if it's lying, but we kind of, like build the school up. Wow, my throat is dry. Hold on. Oh, it's not too hot. We build the school up. Not the school. It's hard to explain. This is, like, a whole topic on its own, because I will never forget those conversations that I had pre-law school. My hopes were up. My hopes were really up, and I was let down, right? So talk to honest current law students who go to that school. Talk to a diverse group of them. Not when I say diverse, I mean, like, black, white, you know, Asian, whatever. I mean diverse in the sense of, like, people who probably had different experiences in law school. And I guess that does kind of factor in race. But I think what you should be looking for is, like, look for someone who had maybe a negative experience, maybe someone who had a positive experience, maybe someone who had a regular experience. And you wouldn't know that just looking at them, but, like, ask them, what was your experience been like? If they're all saying, it's so great. I don't know. I don't think that any law school should be getting that reviewed, no matter how great the law school is. Like, there's always going to be something. If they can't find one, like, thing to tell to say about their law school, they're probably lying to you. No law school is perfect, and if anyone tells you that law school is perfect and there's no issues, there's no problem, administration is great and the students are great and the everything's great, everything's perfect, don't trust it. They're lying to you. So find honest law students. Second, your resume needs to be airtight. I don't remember how I got my resume edited. I don't remember, but there is a way that you're supposed to like do your resume. Like, there's supposed to be a formatting for your resume, make sure you do it that way. And I think also make sure it's like, make sure you, I mean, make sure all the information on there is relevant to what you want to do, but also make sure it shows a very like, again, this is might just be Berkeley specific. Make sure it just shows like a very well-rounded person. Like maybe make sure it doesn't just show like all the academic achievements. Make sure it also shows like the like non-academic achievements. I don't know. I'm really tired, but But another thing, I think the way that you can do that is like in the like at the bottom versus like interest. Like when you talk about your interests, make sure all your interests are not academic. Like talk about interests that are beyond the academic, beyond the legal experience, beyond the legal. Honestly, I don't know. I just feel like schools care about that more than you think that they care about it. They really care about being well-rounded and not just being a really smart person, you know? Just my opinion. Lastly, just for general tips, visit the school. Like, that's something I didn't do. Visit the school. I visited the school after I got in. I didn't visit before I got in. I think if you... the advice on this one is up and down, because I mean, like, it takes money to visit these schools. It's not cheap to fly out or drive out, you know what I mean? It's not an easy thing to do, but like, if you can, go, like, visit your top school. If you don't do anything else, visit your top school, either before you get in, after you get in. That school is the school that you're most likely going to choose. So you want to see how it feels to be in that community, feels to be in that area, you feel comfortable there. And honestly, you may not care about that. I didn't realize how much it mattered to me to be in an area where there's a lot of black people until I got here and there weren't any black people. Not that there were any black people. But yeah, do your research and go to the school, visit the school. The reason why visiting the school matters, because then when you go to the school, you can ask admission, you can show, okay, two things. One, you can ask the admissions office specific questions, because two, that shows genuine interest. And they're probably gonna remember your name because you came all the way, right? Like you're showing added interest. Like I'm probably, like Berkeley probably gets like, I don't even know, thousands of applications a year, right? And for you to be one of the few people who comes to the school, talks to admissions, like tells them who you are, introduces yourself, like, you know, asks good questions, like that's gonna put you, I feel like that's, I didn't do that, but I feel like that puts you on a step ahead. I don't know if it gives you an advantage, but I think it makes the admission, it shows the admissions that like you're serious about the school. Because it's not an easy thing to go to every single school and like be that person. Like people only do that when they're very, very serious about a school. So I personally would say visit the school, ask specific questions, just visit the school. And not just like walk around, but like go inside, talk to admissions, show your face, right? Show your face. And then the second question I usually get, so now I'm done with the basics. Now the question I usually get about like law school is what kind of things, Berkeley specifically, what kind of things does a school like Berkeley want to see on a personal statement / a resume? I'm gonna talk about this a little bit, but the personal statement is really, really big. And I think the two keywords I would use, the two keywords that I think are important when you're writing your personal statement are creativity and uniqueness, right? Like think about the most creative and the most unique way to tell your story. But weave them, this is the kicker, weave it into your desire to go to law school. Your entire personal statement should not be about how you did this and did that and traveled the world and blah, 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 you're so different, you're so unique. No, and then there's no connection to why you wanna go to law school. Like the point is to connect those unique creative stories to your desire to go to law school. And not just any law school, that law school specifically, right? So that's the dilemma that's hard. Again, I will say this, if you are looking for an example personal statement and you want to like read my personal statement, I give it to everyone. I really don't care. Like I really don't care. DM me. I will send you my personal statement. You can read it. I actually had someone professional. Okay. I'm gonna talk about this later. Oh, okay. We'll talk about this now. Focus. Okay. Sorry. I'm just all over the place. I always am. Focus on highlighting your strengths. The point of the personal statement is to highlight your strengths. Don't really spend a lot of time in your personal statement talking about anything except for what you're good at, the ways that you... I mean, obviously, no, that's not true. That's true a little bit, but the whole point of the personal statement, in my opinion, is to show your creativity and uniqueness, but also to show how you've overcome adversity if you have. And because this goes back to my last point. Not goes back, but you know, it's fast forwarding to my last point on this part that says, like, you know, law schools want to see that you can handle the rigor of law school. And if your LSAT score doesn't reflect that, and then if your LSAT score does not reflect that, try to find a way to tell them that in your personal statement, right? So even though a part of your personal statement is about highlighting your successes and your strengths, there's another part of it, if you have a low LSAT score, that you should be using to be like, yeah, I may not have this great score, but these are the ways that I've overcome adversity. These are the ways that I problem solve. These are the ways that I like get past hurdles. Like, I think that it can be twofold, or it can be one or the other, right? Like, if you, it just depends on how good of a storyteller you are. Again, if you want specific advice, please DM me. This is very general, may not apply to everyone advice. And my last piece of advice for this part about personal statements is get a professional to look at your personal statement. Paying for one is worth it. Okay? Highly worth it. I got really lucky and I found, you know, an acquaintance, a colleague who was a professional, and she was willing to help me do it for the free. I obviously paid her because I'm not letting people do that for me. I don't believe in free labor. Craziness. But, you know, if you don't got it like that and you don't have anyone to pay and you find a friend who's just really, like, so is really good at writing and good at editing and they want to do it for you, perfect. If you don't have a friend, if you don't have people in your life who are able to do that and do it well, pay someone. It's such a good investment. It was a great investment for me. You know, it was a great investment for me. Pay someone to look at your personal statement over and over again. Okay? I'm being dead ass. Like, I'm being actually so serious. Like, that helped me so much. It helped me so, so, so much. My throat was so dry. Sorry. Okay. All right. Another question I commonly get is, if my LSAT score is bad, do I need an addendum to address my score? The answer to that, it depends. But, however, the advice that I was given was that addendums are not needed because... Addendums are not needed unless you've had, like, truly extenuating circumstances. Truly extenuating circumstances. There we go. I need to take a nap. Most of us really don't have truly extenuating circumstances. So I would say addendums are not necessary. And the reason why is because addendums, when you talk about your bad LSAT score in your addendum, you're drawing attention to your weak spots rather than highlighting the strengths of your application. That was the advice I was given. I think it was good advice. So I wouldn't write an addendum and be like, oh, like, I just don't test well. I mean, I don't know. That's actually, I wouldn't, right? Even if I didn't test well, I think because that's not my story, I don't know if that would be true or not. But if I didn't test well, I still wouldn't. I personally wouldn't write it. I'm sure other people have given different advice and said, yeah, you should write one. I personally wouldn't, because I think it does bring attention to the weak spots of your application rather than spending your time and your energy highlighting the strengths, right? I think you should spend most of your time and your energy highlighting the strengths and not bringing attention to your weak spots. So that's my only thing about addendums. Another question I usually get is about gap years. Are you for or against it? And then do you need to address your gap years in your personal statement? I would say no. You don't need to adjust your gap years in your personal statement unless it's relevant to your reason for going to law school, then absolutely. But if you're just saying it because, like, no. The whole point of the personal statement is to talk about, like, your resume will show you that. Your resume will show the school that you took some gap years. And I don't think it's necessary. If you took gap years from school and you didn't do anything for a couple of years, I still don't think it's necessary. I don't know. Like, because if I was an admissions officer, I would just assume, oh, they took time off to study for the LSAT, apply to law school. Like, I'm not going to be pressed, right? And if they didn't, how's that my business? They're applying to law school now. Like, I don't know. Personally, it doesn't matter to me. I don't think schools are that pressed about gap years. Again, I could be wrong. But I'm speaking from people who I've talked to, advice that I've gotten. I took one gap year, spent that entire gap year studying for the LSAT, reapplying to law schools. Like, no one asked me about my gap years. That was never a question. You know what I mean? Like, no one cares. I don't know. That's just personally me. Your resume is going to explain it. If your resume doesn't explain it, then they really don't give a care. They don't care at all. They do not care. So I would say you don't need to address it unless it's relevant to what you're writing about. If it's relevant to what you're writing about, because I know during my gap year, I did something really, really fun with my gap year. And so I wrote about that in my personal statement. So that's when it's relevant. If it's not relevant, don't write about it. Like, if you spent, well, I think everything could be relevant, but you know what I mean. Anyways, then someone else asked me a question that I don't think I've heard before. This was actually a very unique question, but they asked, do I need to address gaps between test scores? So, like, for example, if you took your test score 1 year and then 2 years later you took another test, I don't think it matters. I personally don't think it matters, right? Because some people, right, like I said even before, it's better to take more time to do well on this test than to take less time. I don't think law schools care about it. I don't think you need to address it because the admissions officers know that the test is hard and it takes time and resources to get it right. So if you're taking 2 years to go from one score to another, and there's a significant improvement on your score, maybe not significant, but like there's an improvement on your score, they're gonna assume, oh, she spent that time in between test one and test two preparing for test two, right? So I don't think it's necessary. I think it's a good question, but I don't think it's necessary. Schools don't really care. I understand the fear of like, what were you doing that whole time? They don't really care. And the last question, when should I submit applications if my LSAT score is low? I say the earlier the better, but I also understand that a lot of times when people's LSAT scores are low, they're probably going to want to take another test after October. I would say October is a good time to submit application, because I submitted my application in October, and then I heard back from Berkeley in December. I think the earlier the better. However, I understand, like I was saying before, a lot of people who have low LSAT scores are typically trying to take it again. So they probably don't have, like they probably won't be able to fully apply until like a January, right? Or February, right? And that's fine too. I don't know. Me, I'm never gonna say you have to do it at this time. There is no rule, right? I've seen people submit their application the day before the deadline and get in with their score isn't great, right? I mean, I don't know. I feel like everyone's story, this is why I don't like to give advice, right? Because everyone's story is so unique and so different, and it's so, that word, it depends. It depends. It depends. It all depends. It all depends. It all depends. It all depends. Like, I don't know your story, right? Like, I don't know how much you've overcome. I don't know anything about you, right? Like, I'm not you, you're not me, right? Our stories are completely different, and that's actually a really, really good thing. So I can say this is what I did, and just because this is what I did doesn't mean that if you do it too, you'll get the same result. I don't know, right? Or you could do better than I did, right? Like you could apply or get a lower score than I did, apply later, right? Apply in like November, December, get in and get a freaking full ride, right? Like you can do so much better than I did. Even so much better. I just feel like giving advice is so dangerous, because giving advice is like saying if you do ABC, you're gonna get D. It's not true. They may get E. They may get F. They may get F. You know what I mean? I just never want to make someone feel as if they did something wrong or they were wrong in their approach because they took my approach, right? Because my approach is my approach. Your approach is your approach. Do what you think is best for you. But obviously, ask people for advice. Get a diverse amount of advice. But don't like hinge your entire experience on someone else's experience, because we're different. I have a different family background, a different, you know, socioeconomic background. I couldn't write about growing up poor in my personal statement. I can write about that. That would have been dishonest, right? But for some people, for a lot of, you know, people, that's a part of the reason why they want to go to law school. I can't write about having an incarcerated, you know, father in jail, right? I can't write about that, right? There are a lot of things I can't write about because we don't have similar stories, and you may be able to write about that, but because our stories are so different, it's just, everything is just so arbitrary. And I think at the end of the day, you have to do what's best for you. You have to follow, you know, the path that is for you. And you have to trust that God is going to like take you where you need to go in the time that you need to go. I mean, I'm not gonna lie. Like, I did rush. Like, I took an extra year because I had to. But I did rush, and I think even in the rushing, like, God still honored me. But like, if God stops you and God slows you down, like, don't take that personally. Like, God is like, I saw every single piece of every single part of my delay as a part of protection. I don't know. No one's story is perfect. My story definitely isn't perfect, but it definitely got me where I needed to go. And I believe that God is like good enough to write your story in a way that's right for you and makes sense for you. And I don't know. Advice is bad. You shouldn't be giving advice. No one should be giving advice. But I did want to at least address a couple of things that I did feel comfortable talking about on like a larger like setting, sort of like one-on-one with someone. Man. This sleep is catching me, but I have one more video to film. So I'm gonna film that one, and then I'm going to try to get the rest of my day started. But yeah, that's all. That's all I have for this video. If there are other questions that you have that you want me to answer on like the YouTube channel and not just like one-to-one, please send me those questions. I will answer them, or I might just answer them one-to-one. I don't really care. I'm down to do whatever. That's the end of this video. I don't know if it was helpful or not. It probably wasn't, but I hope it was helpful. Sorry for my energy is really low today, so I'm sorry about that. But I talk a little bit slower, a little bit, not a lot, but a little bit slower. Tiredness makes me a little bit slower. But yeah, I'm done, y'all. See you in the next video. We got it together, finally can eat the door, and not every day, but I got it.